take your hip bones and stand. You go to him. 412 and 412. Stand up for Jesus. And we will sing all four verses. Sorry, 413. I apologize. And 413. Stand up for Jesus.
You see what one she's gonna play what she wants.
Here we go. And 413.
Stand up for Jesus.
Services this morning to speak to our hearts, give pastor the words you'd have them to say. And Lord, if there's one here this morning that doesn't know you as their personal Lord and Savior, I pray they get that settled before they leave. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
All right, you may be seated. If you will go to what number? Sorry.
Yeah.
439. Hymn 439, Count Your Blessings, and we will sing all four verses. Hymn 439.
Count your blessings, see what God has done.
441. Hymn 441, Great is Thy Faithfulness. And we will sing all three verses, not four, three verses. Hymn 441.
Sharing a stomach bug. You know, you teach your kids to share and it comes back to haunt you sometimes.
Amen.
So be praying for them that they'll get over that. And then we've got other folks that aren't feeling well, having other issues. All right. Let's see. Remember the service tonight at 6 and Wednesday nights. Yes, Wednesday nights. We're here at 7. And so if you're able to be with us, that would be great. All right. Oh, that's right. Thank you. I haven't looked at the calendar, so. Who here has a birthday this month? Month of August.
The twins are tomorrow.
Yeah.
Landon and Tobias.
They're tomorrow, but they're not here, so we'll have to do this next week. And they like raising their hands. They get me so tickled. They'll be back there. All right. I know there's at least, well, anniversaries this month. Hey, look at that. The Arnolds. Their anniversary was the 16th. 7 years. Seems like it was a week.
When's your anniversary?
Our anniversary was Friday, the 20th.
I guess I only have one.
That's not true. So, and I remember. I'm not going to tell y'all how. We celebrated our 38th anniversary. And that's because Miss Beth was a child bride. I was a child groom. So, any others? Oh, well, happy anniversary. All right. Brother Jim, can I put you to work? All right. If you'll pray for the offering as well as receiving it, sir.
Dear Heavenly Father, Lord God, we do come to you to thank you for this day, time that we can be spent in your house, Lord, to hear your word, something that we can take with us in each day, Lord, that will help get us through these troubled times. Lord, we ask that you take this offering bless it and use it to get the word out to a lost and dying
world. Yes.
Lord, so many have turned away because they don't believe in it. Lord, let us be a spokesman for you. We ask that you go with us through the week, lead, guide, and direct us. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
take your Bibles out and turn to Hebrews. Hebrews chapter 9. This morning, I am going to do my best to answer a question that I've heard and that there seems to be some confusion about, and that is, what happens after we die?
Go to heaven.
Amen. Amen. If you're saved, yes. And that's our hope and desire, is that everybody knows the Lord as their personal Savior. Here, Hebrews chapter 9, look at verse 27. And as it is appointed unto men once to die, but after this, the judgment. So, with all the differences that everybody here has, everybody watching from home, there's one thing we all have in common. We're all going to die. With the main caveat, if you're saved and you're alive when Christ calls the church out, then you don't have to go through that passageway we call death. And I call death a passageway because that's what it is. And I'll say more about that. But I want to tell you some things I've heard from people about what happens when we die. And if there's anybody here that this is what you think, don't raise your hand and say, yeah, that's right. Because if you believe one of these first few things I cover, you're wrong. Okay? And if you want to acknowledge that publicly, that's up to you. One thing that I've heard is that when we die, we become angels. Have y'all heard that? Maybe you've not heard somebody actually come out and say that, but what you may have heard is, oh, so-and-so got their wings. What do they mean? Well, they died. Well, what wings did they get? Right? They're implying angels' wings. And oftentimes, with the death of a child, they'll say, well, there went one of God's little angels. You know, and I remember a particular church, they had a cantata, and the way it unfolded, people would go up and sit in the choir loft, and then they became angels for the cantata in the choir loft. And somebody said, well, it's just like real life. And I was like, what? And part of this is there are TV programs, right? Highway to Heaven. Right, that's a feel-good show. I got to be honest, I've never watched it, but I'm familiar with it. Right, I think that's one that Michael Landon was behind and starred in, and it's about people. They died and became angels, and now they're trying to help other people. Touched by an Angel, very similar. There are movies out there. Angels in the Outfield. My girls watched that when they were little. Right? And one of my all-time favorite movies, It's a Wonderful Life. I try to watch it every Christmas. I'll tell you a secret, I usually cry when I watch it. But the premise of that movie is around Clarence. You thought Jimmy Stewart was the star, but Clarence is this angel third class because he hasn't gotten his wings, right? And one of the little themes in the movie is every time you hear bells,
somebody gets their wings.
An angel's got his wings, right? I like the movie, but listen, I don't get my theology from television.
Amen.
or the movies. You know, I don't get my theology from Hollywood. Nobody should. But there are so many people that believe that when we die, we become angels. We do not. Now, let me do say this. Angels can and do take on human form. That's what the Bible teaches. We saw that in Genesis. Right? We know the story. We know what happened. God decided that he was going to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah. And after Abraham whittled them down to only 10 souls, 10 righteous, there weren't 10. So God said, I'm going to destroy it. And what did he do? He dispatched two angels to go down and say, Lot, you and your family, you need to get out of here. They were angels, but they were in human form. And we know that because the men of Sodom saw them and said, hey, bring them out that we may know them. Right? And then those angels were able to blind them. And ultimately, those angels, they took on human form. And they were literal bodies because those angels had to literally take Lot and his family by the hand and drag them out. So, also, look at Hebrews. We're in Hebrews. Go to chapter 13. And look at verse 2. Be not forgetful to entertain strangers, for thereby some have entertained angels unawares. See, angels still today can, and I believe they do, take on human form. You may have interacted with an angel and didn't know it. See, Hollywood can't touch that. They try.
Thank the Lord.
But that's reality. And man, my Bible says, you know, the lesson there is when you interact with strangers, you may be interacting with an angel. Okay? Now, there are so many angels. We know that the prettiest angel ever created was Lucifer. And therein was part of his problem. I know nobody here's never done this. I know definitely not to the degree he did, but he got a big head. He started thinking higher than himself, than he ought to. And he decided, you know what? I'm going to set my seat above God. And we can go to Isaiah, we can read the rebellion, right? And so he was expelled from heaven. And the Bible teaches us that one third of angelic beings went with him. See, when God created the angels, he created them just like he created you and I. Well, actually, he created us. We were custom handmade. Amen?
Amen.
He just spoke them into existence. God did not say, okay, when you die, you're going to become an angel. That's not. Angels are eternal, right? They don't die. One of my favorite Christian authors is Frank Peretti. He's written Piercing the Darkness, This Present Darkness. He's written several others, and he takes poetic license in This Present Darkness and Piercing the Darkness. He talks about how heavenly angels are fighting what we call demons, and how that when they slice them with the swords, they disappear and go into the abyss. Well, that's not reality. Angels are not going to disappear. They don't die. They are eternal beings. That's why we read about some angels being chained because of their sin. And that these angels that rebel, they're going to be dealt with. That's what hell was created for. Hell was created for Satan and the angels that rebelled with him. So when you die, if you're saved, you're going to go to heaven. And we're going to talk about that, but you do not become an angel. Scary thing is, you know, some of you, this is the closest ever to being an angel you'll be. Right? Now, we, you know, as parents, as mothers, oh, my little angel, right, that grows up to be a terror, right? That's what my mom said about my brothers, and that was true, right? You know why I'm the youngest? Because when I was born, they got perfection. It took six tries, but they made it. So, brother, say amen. You're throwing me with comments because I'm trying to listen to you. So what does the Bible say? Now, that's what I've heard people say about when you die, you become an angel.
Yes.
Right? And I know that some people hold to that because that's, you know, they say, my loved one is my guardian angel, right? My loved one is my angel watching over me. And you know, these are things that people say to make people feel better, but I don't like that because it's not accurate. It's dishonest. It's not true to God's word. And I don't like it. And if you've said this, I'm not mad at anybody. But when somebody dies and somebody tells a child, God took them because God wanted them with him. The only way God takes anybody is they're alive. We have two biblical examples of God taking somebody. Enoch walked with God and was not, because God took him. Enoch did not see death. Amen?
Amen.
Neither did Elijah. He didn't see death. Man, he got to ride a chariot of fire. That's how God takes. The wages of sin is death. So please, you have a little one and their mom or dad or sibling dies or their grandparents, don't tell them that God took them because God wanted them there with him. Because what you're telling that child is, God doesn't care about you. God is selfish. And he took your loved one because God wanted him in heaven with him more than he wanted him with you. And that's not the truth. As much as I thank God for my children, and the gift that he gave me with my children, they might not think of it this way, but I'm a gift to them. God made me their parent. Yes. Right? And so when we say that, you know, we got to be honest when it comes to this issue of death. Listen, and when people say, Why did Grandpa die? He never hurt anybody. He was a good man. And right, and that's what that child sees, and that's what that child believes. And you know what? You're right. He was, but you know, here's the thing. The good thing is, if they're saved, the good thing is they're saved. And they're in heaven. And if you're saved, you'll be reunited. Right? But we can't just use these sayings. Right? Oh, well, Grandpa's now my angel watching over me. That's not true. He's not an angel. Right? So here's what the Bible says. All right. Hebrews 9:27. Right? We already looked at that. It is appointed unto man once to die, but after this, the judgment. And that's an appointment we're all going to keep. And if the Lord were to take the church out right now, we're going to keep the second half of that, the judgment. You say, whoa, but I'm saved. We're going to stand before the Bema seat. Praise God. The Bema seat. We're gonna stand before God, and we're going to be judged for our works, right? Our works are going to be judged, and they're going to be filtered out, whether they're wood, hay, and stubble, or silver, gold, and precious stones. Amen. And remember, when they are tried for the sort, not the size. Right? When we stand before God, hopefully I want to hear, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Amen? So, when physical death comes, let's go to Luke chapter 16. Brother Tommy was there 2 weeks ago, and Brother John was there in Sunday school. Luke chapter 16. When physical death happens, listen to me. When physical death happens, this fleshly tabernacle in which we dwell ceases to function. But you continue. When physical death comes, it simply means the end of our physical life on earth, but our consciousness is eternal. You follow me? Our consciousness is eternal. You say, well, what's this? Why does the Bible talk about eternal life? Because when you enter that passageway we call death, and we call it a passageway because you are leaving the physical realm into the eternal. And eternal life is life in heaven. Eternal death is life in hell. See, death means separation. So when this physical dies, Stacy is separated from this earthly tabernacle. But Stacy still exists and will exist for eternity. By God's grace, Stacy is saved. So I will have eternal life in heaven. When somebody that does not know Christ dies, there are two deaths. There's the physical death, but then down the road, they're going to be cast into the lake of fire after they appear before the great white throne of judgment. That's not the judgment for the believer, right? The believer's going to be before the Bema seat. The lost are going to be before the great white throne of judgment. And Brother Tommy touched on it when he preached on it 2 weeks ago. And the books of life are going to be opened. And those whose name are not found in the Lamb's book of life will be cast into the lake of fire. And that is the second death. Right? Death is separation. And that second death is they will be separated for all eternity from God. Now, I don't know when that great white throne of judgment is going to be. If you die today, and it's not for another 1,000 years for the human, those that are alive on earth, in that time, you're going to be in hell. Here, we see what happens, and Tommy did a great job on this, and I'm not preaching on it because I feel like he didn't. This is just a message that the Lord gave me, and it just so happens it's now. But we look here, look at Luke 16, verse 19. There was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus which was laid at his gate full of sores and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. So one thing you have to know, this is not a parable. How do we know? First of all, every time Jesus gave a parable, he said, this is a parable. We call that in law enforcement a clue. And secondly, he gave us Lazarus' name. And in a parable, he doesn't name anybody because it's a parable. It's not a true event. This was a true event. So he named Lazarus. Verse 20. And it came to pass that the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried. Verse 23. And in hell, he lifted up his eyes, being in torments. Wow. Here's the thing. They both died, and we see. Now, you have to remember, at this time, Jesus hadn't been crucified. Therefore, he hadn't risen from the dead. Now, before he rose from the dead, where was Jesus? He was in hell. What was he doing? He was preaching. When he came out of the center of the earth, did he come alone? No. At the time of this writing, when Jesus is telling this story, this true event, what we call heaven, which here is called paradise, was in the center of the earth as well. Right? And we're going to see that. Verse 23. And in hell he lifted up his eyes, being in torments, and seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom. And he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus, that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. But Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest thy good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things. But now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And besides this, besides all this, between us and you is a great gulf fixed, so that they which would pass from hence to you cannot, neither can they pass to us that would come from thence. Okay, so if you could picture in your mind the center of the earth, imagine a cavern, a large cavern, and there's a big gulf between them, so great that nobody could jump or whatever. And on one side is hell. On the other side is Abraham's bosom, or paradise. Before Jesus Christ was resurrected, that was where the dead in Christ went. When he was resurrected, he brought those saved out of the heart of the earth. And they are now in heaven. And so now, the heart of the earth, all of it, is hell. A little side note, not really anything to do with the message. Y'all know about all the earthquakes and everything that's going on. You know, this is part of the end times that we read about in God's Word. He said that there are going to be earthquakes in diverse places. You know, there was an earthquake in North Carolina. This is last week. That's not an area you're used to hearing about. California, another day, right? North Carolina, Georgia, Tennessee. You don't hear about earthquakes happening there often. Did you know that there are 3 volcanoes in Alaska that are erupting? And I was talking with somebody recently, and they said, Dad, don't you think that these eruptions are part of hell expanding itself? See, hell is expanding itself. This rich man, now I want to say that he did not go to hell because he was rich. He did not go to hell because he was inside his mansion, living his luxurious life, while Lazarus sat at his gates, being sick and poor and starving. That's got nothing to do with why that rich man went to hell. He went to hell because he did not accept Jesus Christ as his Savior. Mm-hmm. Bottom line. Had nothing to do with his bank account, with his station in life, the way he lived his life, nothing. Lazarus did not go to heaven because he was a beggar, full of sores, laying at a gate, wishing for crumbs. That's not why he got to heaven. He got to heaven because he did accept Christ as his personal Savior. All right, so a lot of people say, see, rich people can't go to heaven. I know rich people as friends. And when I say rich people, I don't mean that they've got $1.98 in the bank. Right? I know some millionaires. And they love the Lord. And they take their money and they use it in the service of the Lord. And that's part of the reason they're millionaires. Is because they honored God. They recognize that God's the one that gave them the abilities to earn what they were earning. And they wanted to serve Him. And it's funny how that works, isn't it? You can't outgive God. Man, you think you got a big shovel? God's got a steam shovel. All right? That had nothing to do with the message either. You're going to be conscious. Whether you're in heaven or you're in hell, you are going to be conscious. Man, and Tommy did great showing us from God's word what hell is going to be like. And I can't, our imagination doesn't do justice. No matter how vivid your imagination may be, it doesn't do justice. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Paul said, we are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. To be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. You notice Lazarus was escorted by angels. He didn't become one. Right? He was escorted by angels into Abraham's bosom. People ask questions. And, you know, it's okay to ask questions. It's okay to question God. It's even okay to be angry at God. God can handle that. Some people say, in heaven, aren't we going to miss our life here on earth? The analogy I heard that I thought was great was, let's say that you got a ticket for a flight, and you get there and you're going to fly coach or business class, whichever is worse. I just get what they give me. And you get to the airport and they say, listen, we oversold and there's no more room in coach, but we'll put you in first class. Do you think while you're sitting up there in first class, you're going to be saying, I wish I was back in coach? I wonder what things are like in coach. I wonder what their meal is like. I wish I had their meal. Right? No, you're going to be sitting up there in first class like, hey, this is living. Woo, I got room. I can move my elbows, right? I've got a real life with my food. That's an analogy that we all can identify with. If you've never flown even, you can understand it. Heaven is such an upgrade. It is such an upgrade. We are going to be overwhelmed. We're going to be overwhelmed with what we see and hear, and I think even what we smell. We're going to have all our senses. And man, they're going to be on overdrive. Right? People say, well, aren't we going to be bored? Right? You mean I got to sit around all day playing the harp? I don't even like music. No, I believe that in heaven you're going to have a job to do. Why do I say that? Look at Genesis chapter 2. If you have one of my Bibles, it's page 3. Okay, Genesis chapter 2. Give everybody a chance to get there. I don't want to leave anybody behind. Look at verse 15. This is after the creation of the garden. And the Lord took the man and put him into the Garden of Eden to dress it and to keep it. Now, was the Garden of Eden flawed? Not at this time. Not at this time. God created the most beautiful garden. We were talking about flowers and God's creation. Could you imagine the world before sin? How beautiful things were. I look at the world after sin and how beautiful things are. But so God took the man. God created this beautiful garden. Right? And folks like Tommy and Brother Billy say this is how we know God intended you to fish, because he put rivers.
Amen.
In the garden, right? Here's this paradise on earth, if you will, and God still put man there, and he said that he's there, and he's to keep and dress the garden. That was God's plan. The fact that we're in heaven doesn't mean that we don't have to work. I think in heaven, we are going to continue with God's original plan. See, before sin, God came and walked with Adam and Eve daily in the garden. He had daily fellowship with them. That's why he created man. And so now when we go to heaven, removed from sin, the penalty of sin, the practice of sin, and the presence of sin, all that's gone. And so I think we're not going to have time to get bored. We're going to have a job to do. Right? And it's going to be enjoyable. Well, I believe that in heaven we're still going to experience emotions. God experienced emotions, did he not? Right? Joy. Laughter. Anger. I don't think we're going to have to deal with the emotion of sadness for two reasons. One, the Bible says that God will wipe away all tears in heaven. And two, the joy and the blessedness of being in the presence of God will overshadow anything negative that we may have had here on this earth. Some people say, yeah, but won't we be sad because we're missing family? I think that's why that initially there are tears in heaven, is because we're going to be present. We're going to be at the great white throne of judgment as spectators. We are not going before it. I believe, and I would love to be wrong, but I believe that we will be seeing the goings on And we're going to see people that we knew. We're going to see friends and maybe family that are going to be tossed in a lake of fire. And that's going to bring tears, folks. But then God will wipe away those tears. And then I think that being in his presence will so overshadow all that negative. Here's something for you to realize, that when we get to heaven, we're still not going to know everything. Only God is omniscient. And God will forever be the only one that is omniscient, meaning knows everything. You and I won't, which I'm okay with. Then I can go to the Lord and ask questions. Right? I can go to Peter and ask him some questions. How far did you get out of the boat? I want to know. I don't think it was just one or two steps. I think he got some distance. Right? But that's what happened. He got away from the boat. He hadn't quite reached the Lord. And he took his eyes off the Lord and onto the circumstances. Started to sing. So we're not going to know everything in heaven. We will look at 1 Corinthians 13. This is a question I think a lot of people have, and it's, will we still know each other in heaven? Will we still know each other? 1 Corinthians chapter 13, look at verse 12. For now we see through a glass darkly, but then face to face. Now I know in part, but then shall I know even also as I am known. When you go to heaven, God doesn't pass you through a machine that erases your memory. Here, Paul said, listen, when I'm there, and you say, how do you know that's what he's talking about? He says, for now, we see through a glass darkly. Right? We can't see things clearly when it comes to some spiritual things and the topic of heaven. He says, but then, face to face. And he says, and I will know, and even also, as I am also, I am known. So, we're going to know each other in heaven. And that's why I'll understand if I'm walking down the pearly, go through the pearly gates, walking on the golds of the street, and I see you coming, and you look at me and turn around and go the other way, I understand. I won't be mad. I might even be thankful. Look at Psalm 16. We're going to go all the way to the book of Psalms, and we're going to go to the 16th Psalm. And this goes back to what heaven is going to be like. And listen, I'm a horrible painter, and I'm doing a horrible job of painting the scene. But that's why I'm letting Scripture do the talking. But here in Psalm 16, verse 11, that will show me the path of life. In thy presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand, there are pleasures forevermore. You know, you'll hear some people say out of ignorance, well, I'd rather have a party in hell than to be bored in heaven.
Lord, help me.
Well, can I tell you something? You're not going to have a party in hell. It's not going to be a party. See, we said that there's eternal existence. You are going to exist for eternity. Eternal life is heaven. Eternal death is hell. In hell, when we are looking at Luke 16, we saw, just as Tommy brought to us 2 weeks ago, the rich man, being in hell, opened up his eyes in torments. And that's eternal. That's non-stopping. If you have a chronic illness, and if that illness is one of pain, I think it was 2011 I was diagnosed with chronic migraines. So I have the gift of a headache all the time. And the doctors did the best they could, and essentially the bottom line was, Mr. Carpenter, you've got to learn to live with it. We can show you how to reduce it, and we can show you how to hopefully minimize migraines when they come. And I didn't realize how much my migraines affected the rest of my family. I knew how much it affected me, right? But it affected my wife and my children. And I know what it is to have never-ending pain. But what I'm experiencing here is heaven compared to what they're going to experience in hell. Right? Because the Bible says that it's a fire that will never be quenched. Tommy talked about, it says, where the worm dieth not. Man, y'all know what sand fleas are?
Yep.
If you're unfamiliar with them, go to Paris Island. They import them there. Or maybe they're the manufacturer, I don't know. But you can't see them. They identify their presence by biting. And I think about those sand fleas and how annoying they were and how painful they were. And part of that might be because we had to stand there and take it and couldn't react. But that's nothing compared to the worm that dieth not. That worm is going to be gnawing on you for eternity. You remember the fire in the burning bush when God presented himself to Moses? What did it say about that? There was a fire, but the bush was not consumed. The worm that dieth not is going to be gnawing on you, but you're not going to be consumed. There's going to be no end. And then it talks about the gnashing of teeth. I used to think that would be the teeth that were going to be biting the individual. I don't think that's it. It's the individual's teeth. They're going to be gnashing their own teeth because of the pain. Listen, I know that Deanna suffers migraines, and I'm sure she's had times. I had times where I wanted to put my head in a vise and just clamp it down until my noggin popped because it couldn't hurt any worse. That is nothing compared to what hell's going to be like. And the horrible thing is, my migraines were genetic. I inherited it from my mom. Valerie inherited it from me. Not a whole lot we can do except deal with it. But nobody has to go to hell. No one has to go to hell. And people say, I don't think the loving God would send anybody to hell. And you are right. God didn't create hell for man. He created hell for Satan and the fallen angels. And God has done everything in his power that you might be saved. He sent his only begotten son to die a horrific death. We can't even fathom what Christ went through. The physical pain. He survived the beating that would have killed a regular man. But you see, they couldn't kill him. Why? Because the wages of sin is death. And Christ never sinned. So they could do whatever they wanted to him, and he would not die. He couldn't. That's why after he was nailed to the cross, and in my mind's eye, I can see when Jesus is being nailed to the cross, when they're putting the first one in, the first hand, I could even imagine Jesus holding it. And I could imagine him, the hammer's falling, and he's looking in the face of that soldier. And he said, I want you to be in paradise with me. Even though you're doing this, I love you. I'm doing this for you. Could you imagine? But they did not kill him. It wasn't until Jesus declared, it is finished. And the Bible says then he gave up the ghost. See, nobody has to go to hell. Listen, you're not predestined to go to hell. Nor are you predestined to salvation. If you are predestined to hell, then God's a liar. Because in his word, he says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. In his word, he said, I am not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. So nobody has to die and go to hell. God doesn't want you to die and go to hell. God wants you to accept his finished work on Calvary and accept his son, Jesus Christ, as your Savior. Then we can meet in heaven and you can tell me how wrong I was. You can say, preacher, you didn't do a good enough job. It's way better than I thought. Because it will be. Right? Our imaginations, we, as imaginative as some people in this room are, and some of them I know their imagination very well, can't come close to what heaven's going to be like. I'm okay not becoming an angel when I die. See, angels don't understand salvation. Right? They don't understand the rejoicing over a sinner saved. The Bible doesn't say that angels rejoice over a sinner saved. You say, oh, but it does. No. It says there's rejoicing in the presence of angels when a sinner is saved. They don't rejoice because they don't understand it. Right? And I got to tell you, I don't have to fully understand it. I just have to accept it. Amen? Do you know for sure you're saved? I don't mean, are you on the church roll? Do you go to Sunday school? Those things are important. But have you personally accepted Christ as your Savior? If you haven't, what are you waiting for? The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Right? Nobody's promised. I used to say tomorrow, but we're not promised an hour. Right? If you have any doubts, you need to get that settled. If you're watching at home or online, wherever you may be, if you're not sure of your salvation, put a comment in there, send me a message, and I will get with you, and I will take God's word and show you how you can know that you are saved. I'm not saved because I'm a preacher. That's a good thing. My preaching ability determined my salvation. I'd be scared. I'm saved because I accepted what Christ did. And that's how you're saved. Let's stand to our feet, if you will. Heads bowed, eyes closed, Christians praying. No one looking around. The invitation is very simple. If you're not 100% sure of your salvation, please come. Let us show you from God's word how you can know for sure you're saved. Again, those of you watching online, send me a message. If you're local, I will try to work something out. If you're not local, still, I'll communicate with you any way I can. Invitation simple. If you're not sure, here in this room, if you're not 100% sure, would you raise your hand?
I'll pray for you. I won't embarrass you, but I will pray for you. All right, folks, if Lord's spoken to your heart about anything, let me encourage you. Be obedient to him. Follow his leading. Our Heavenly Father, as we bow in your presence, we are so thankful for your watch care over us, your goodness to us, but most of all, the salvation that you have so freely given to us. It wasn't free to you. You paid a heavy price, but it doesn't cost us anything. I ask that you'd help us to live for you. Help us to be used of you to bring others to a saving knowledge of you. Heads bowed, eyes closed. Miss Beth is going to play. If you need to come for any reason, please step out on the first verse.